for short. I'm the president of SADACA, the Student Association for the Development of Arab Cultural Awareness. It has a long name because SADACA means friendship in Arabic. We're very happy to have you today. We'd like to, before we begin, we'd like to thank our supporters and co-sponsors from the Rochester community, Christians Witnessing Palestine, Jewish Voices for Peace, and from the University of Rochester campus, ADT, the Association for the Development of Interest in the Indian Subcontinent, BSU, Black Students Association, MSA, Muslim Students Association, and Sigma Beta Rho Fraternity. Our speaker for today is an eminent activist for civil and human rights. In 1980, Hagler was ordained in the United Church of Christ and was recognized with full standing in the Christian Church the following year. Today, the Reverend Mr. Hagler is a senior minister of Plymouth Congregational United Church of Christ in Washington, D.C., and the immediate past national president of Ministers for Racial, Social, and Economic Justice. Our guest speaker will speak for about 40 to 45 minutes, and this will allow you some time for questions at the end. We ask you to write down your thoughts and reflections on the sheet of paper that you were given and save them to ask at the end. So without further ado, Reverend Graylan Hagler.
Thank you so much for that introduction. And it's good to be here, everybody. It's good to see everyone here today. And I was just making a joke when you said we're going to speak for 40 minutes, you said? I don't even do sermons that long, y'all. So, you know, but we'll get to the heart of the matter. It's good to be here at the University of Rochester. And some of you may have know that we had some rough spots in terms of coming to Rochester at all. I ended up receiving some threats on my life, and we got canceled out of one speaking site, which was at the Divinity School, at the Colgate Rochester Divinity School. For whatever reason, no, I don't blame the Divinity School at all, because I don't know what happened on the inside to make them make that decision. But it became also apparent to me, and it's been apparent to me for some time, that there's certain issues that we have a hard time discussing in this country and in the world. We have a hard time discussing, for example, racism and its manifestations. And we have a hard time definitely speaking about Palestine or Muslims in this country, because we have seen what happened recently in terms of the Republican candidates, Ben Carson and Donald Trump, who seems to basically take the ideology to the lowest base level that public discourse can ever go to. It is xenophobic and it's racist in character. I was talking to someone over lunch just a little while ago, but one thing we need to remember, even as we talk about sort of the presidential debates, Republican presidential debates, one of the things, if you recollect, Donald Trump, as he talked about, opened up his campaign, he talked about Mexicans as rapists and murderers, and then there were some good ones. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
Now understand the code language. The code language during slavery and Reconstruction was that black men were going to rape white women. So it's a code word because he could have easily said, if he was going to use that type of xenophobic rhetoric, he could have said, oh, they're robbers and murderers. Not that they're rapists, because that's a code language that folks begin to understand in America that applies to either black men hiding in the shadows or brown men willing to pop out of the shadows and capture those that you were called to protect. So we understand the racist language that exists there. Sisters and brothers, one of the things is that we do know is that racism, it continues to perpetuate itself because we don't discuss it. We don't discuss it. People are always telling us what you should feel. We've been dealing in Washington, D.C. around changing the name of the Washington football team, the professional football team, from what native folks have called disparaging and racist. And yet everybody has to say, they say, well, what is racism about it? You need to stop being so hypersensitive. You need to stop seeing race in everything. Because in a sense, what happens is that we are always taught not to talk about race and racism as a society, as a country. Somebody always said, you can pull out the race card, right? You heard that? Now, it's mighty interesting to me that black folks, if we talk about racism in this country, we're told over and over again that it's not race, it's class. You need to stop pulling the race card, you need to stop being overly sensitive, and that goes on and on and on. Have you ever noticed this one thing, that when you're a woman and you say something is sexist, you gotta argue with folks to try to prove that it's sexist? And when you're a person of color and you say something is racist, you gotta argue with folks to try to prove that it's racist because they don't believe you? But all of a sudden, in our society, the way it's structured, you say anti-Semitism, and all of a sudden the whole thing goes silent. Right? It's the end of the discussion. Well, I'm not trying to make light of it. Anti-Semitism exists. Racism exists. Sexism exists. Homophobia exists. Let us get things out in the open as civilized people and begin to deal with it. And one of the things that we need to get out in the open also is the kind of wars that we are engaged in, because basically in our foreign policy, we're structured to protect Israel. Structured to protect Israel, so we end up, in a sense, destabilizing all of the Middle East basically upon that hypothesis that Israel must be protected. I was there in Israel in January of 2014. What was interesting for me, I hadn't been in Israel, the previous time I was in Israel was 1974, so it was 40 years prior. And so I had this snapshot in my mind when we went in January 2014 of what was there, what I was gonna see, what it was gonna look like, what it was gonna feel like. And it was a snapshot of 40 years ago where you could move into places like Bethlehem, you could move and go to Nazareth, and you could go into Jerusalem. And yes, it was 7 years after the 1967 war, but it still had, in a sense, it was open and there was a different kind of flow to it. To go back 40 years later and to see Israel as an armed camp, basically using its power, its military power, to keep Palestinians subjugated, to basically control their movement, to control their livelihoods, to control educational hopes. I was down in Bethlehem, for example, in one of the refugee camps, I think it was Beth Jala. And you could see that people were crammed down into what really was a sort of network of alleyways. Where people lived, and many people had been there, at least from families that had been there since 1948. And basically surrounded by, yes, they were supposedly in Palestinian territory, but it was interesting to me, the Palestinian Authority sat outside of the refugee camp, armed to the teeth, ready to move into the refugee camp to basically quell any kind of uprising. So their job was to be able to keep the refugee camp in check, which just basically said to me that a big part of the Palestinian Authority really operates with permission, under the guidance of the state of Israel. And so there's not freedom, there's not real democracy. What you really see is an apartheid system that exists. There's a wall that meanders, not just on on Israeli territory, but it meanders going over into Palestinian territory so that you control movement, you control water, you control basically whether people are able to get from here to there safely, from hospitals safely, all those kinds of things. So you end up not in a free society at all. What we were meant to see when we went there, we were all black delegation in 2014, of hip-hop artists, old preacher like me, and another friend of mine who is an organizer and had also been the executive director of Trans Africa, Bill Fletcher. And so we were the old heads on the delegation. And what we saw immediately, me and Bill, particularly being the older ones there, we saw what we had seen. If you understand what I'm saying, we experienced Jim Crow. We experienced places where people could not go. We think that we got police brutality right now in some of the cities. We experienced a different kind of police brutality when I was growing up. We experienced everything that we saw that was going on around us in Palestine and Israel. And finally, as people tried to explain to us what was going on, I found myself saying, no, I understand it. I see it. I've experienced it. I've lived in segregated communities. I've lived with neighborhoods that I could not wander over into. In fact, even when I was pastoring in Chicago, I shall never forget that one evening I was on the edge of Chicago and next to Oak Park. If anybody's from that area, you sort of know the geography a little bit. And I wanted ice cream one hot summer night. So I got in my car to go over to the convenience store to get ice cream. And the minute I crossed the Chicago line, I got stopped by a police officer who didn't ask to see my license or registration, but instead put handcuffs on me and took me to the police station to prove who I was and what I was doing over in that neighborhood. And what I'm getting at is that in America, there's been those kinds of Jim Crow structures, either formally or informally, that have existed. And so moving through the occupied territories, our eyes quickly saw checkpoints for Palestinians. We saw roads that existed deep in Palestinian territory that were exclusively for Jewish use, for Israeli use, that they could travel through the territories on roads that Palestinians could not be on. One of the most heartbreaking things for me was down in Hebron. And there was a massacre that took place in Hebron with a rabbi out of Brooklyn went into the mosque and machine gunned a number of folks. And so we were down at that mosque and I was looking at it, and the other side of the mosque is now a synagogue. And I was just very curious about the movement of people, that you have a mosque over here and you have a synagogue over here and the buildings are connected. So I'm standing in the park and I'm walking around and I'm looking at the plaques in the park. Many supporters of the synagogue got plaques in the park in Hebron. And so I'm reading the plaques. I turned around and it dawned on me that there was one military vehicle sitting in front of the synagogue when I started. And now there were six military vehicles sitting in front of the synagogue and they were all looking in my direction. Now I'm from Baltimore, I'm from the city, so I know it's time to move slowly, right? As if you're not in a panic, so that you don't draw any attention. Well, they had seen me because by the time I hooked up with my delegation who was in the town, a platoon of these soldiers came running, screaming at us for our papers, waving automatic weapons at our faces, demanding to see the papers. The delegation that I was with froze, they produced their papers. And I have to admit to you that maybe I had been going through some post-traumatic stress, but I had my hand on my passport, but my arm would not move. And now I was the only one who had not shown my papers to these soldiers who were demanding to see my papers. And now the guns were solely trained on me and they were screaming at me at the top of their voice. And I still couldn't move my hand. And the only thing I could think to say was, why? And their response was, because Arabs are not allowed on this road. Now keep in mind, we're deep in occupied territory. It is nothing but Arabs in that area. And then all of a sudden he said it so clearly that the next thing occurred to me, I always say this to people and people tell me to stop doing it, but I said, where are you from? And he turned out to be from Chicago. And when he told me he was from Chicago, I said, now you know I'm not going to show you no papers. I said, you are all the way over here. You from Chicago in an Israeli uniform pointing a gun at me. I am not going to show you my papers. You can shoot me in the back if you want. And I turned around and I began to walk away, which scared the daylights out of my delegation. But you know, I'm a Baltimore hothead. What can I say? It gets to a part where you just have to stand up. But again, you realize that in a place like that, what's going on is that there's more and more Israeli settlements that are planted there, that again encroaches on Palestinian lands more and more. They get larger and larger. First of all, a settlement comes into the occupied territory and it is like a temporary village, and then it begins to take on permanence, and then it continues to grow and expand until it begins to eat up and take away more and more Palestinian territory. And what that means, if you look at it, there's settlements all over, deep in the West Bank, all over. There's no reason, there's no rational way that anybody can talk about with any kind of clarity or sincerity that there is to be a two-state solution. A two-state solution does not count and will not work in Palestine and Israel unless, first of all, they begin to dismantle those settlements that have encroached into Palestinian territory. So what they're doing when they say that, this two-state solution, they're buying time. They're buying time so that there'll be more settlements. They're buying time so that there would be a continued increase of people living illegally in occupied territories. And eventually, in the end, there will be no land that is left that would be considered Palestinian land. That's largely what's going on. We met with a former commander who is now a part of a peace group. When I say former commander, former commander from the Israeli Defense Forces, who's now organized a peace group. I think it's called Breaking the Silence. And as he says, our standing orders in the military is to make our presence known. And I asked him, I said, what does that mean? He said, to make your presence known, you arbitrarily move people, you push people, you tell folks that they're violating the law. It's always arbitrarily enforced. It's to keep people off balance and to remind people that you're in charge and they are not. So it's a part of the whole tactic. Now, if you look at what's going on with Ferguson and Baltimore and places like that, it was years and years of police making their presence known. And don't get it twisted, because one thing that has also happened is that police departments in the United States have largely gone to Israel to be trained in tactics of occupation, in tactics of keeping people in check. And let me tell you, that's not going to social work school, y'all. That is going and trying to figure out how you actively use your powers, the powers that have taken place and have been so corrupt in places like Ferguson and in Baltimore. I grew up in Baltimore, like I said, not too far from where Freddie Gray was killed, right down the street. And one thing that existed there, all those burned out houses that you see in that part of Baltimore, in Sandtown, as it's called, they're not a result of any riot. They're a result of direct financial disinvestment from those neighborhoods. And when you walk around there today, 2015, and you talk to people in that neighborhood, it reminds me of the Batjala refugee camp. The hopelessness, the being surrounded by everybody and everything, but having no ability to access it yourself. Existing where there is high unemployment, where folks are just stacked on top of one another. Yes, it exploded in Baltimore. It exploded in Baltimore because there had been a lack of political leadership for so long. I was over there at Mondawmin Shopping Mall, where my parents used to take me when I was little to go to the grocery store, to go to the market. I was out there when it broke out. And one of the things, sometimes you travel places and you get a different understanding of what's taking place at home. And sometimes after you have traveled places, you begin to reflect a little bit differently. One of the things I saw in Baltimore, that night it was young folks with bricks and rocks going up against blocks. It wasn't just looting and burning. I watched young folks almost in militaristic fashion go up against the police department. That's why the police kept retreating, because they had not seen anything like that when you had riot gear that was basically shattered and broken on the streets of Baltimore. And they kept withdrawing and kept withdrawing. And it was a good thing they probably withdrew, because there would have been a bloodbath one way or the other out there in the streets of Baltimore that night. But I began to realize that on the next day, 2 days after the uprising, all of a sudden the political leadership in Baltimore started changing its rhetoric. The media wanted the politicians in Baltimore to refer to those who were engaged in the uprising as thugs. You may remember that. Maybe you remember some discourse around that. And most of the people in Baltimore, the political leadership, refused to engage in calling them by that name as thugs. And in fact, one city council member from Baltimore said to one of the CNN reporters, said, why don't you call them what you really want to call them? That was his response. Call them. He said, go ahead. You want to call them nigger. You had to go ahead and call them nigger. Which the reporter backed up at that point, because she wanted him to do it. Right? The issue is that the political machinery in Baltimore had to figure out a way, at least in rhetoric, to get back out in front of the young folks. Because the young folks had left them. The young folks said, you're irrelevant. The young folks said, you haven't delivered jobs. The young folks said, you haven't done anything about our education. The young folks said, we're being locked up wholesale. and they knew the political leadership had left them. Well, what do you think the Intifada was about? The Intifada basically was saying to the PLO, you have left us, you have tried to become diplomats, and you've tried to become this and that, while we're still in refugee camps, and while we still cannot return home, and those who are in the diaspora can't come home again. And so basically, in the Intifada, there was a reaction, a response by young folks that were saying to the old leadership, you need to pick up the torch again and deal with this differently, because you're not helping us. There was clearly a relationship between the two, because just like when I saw in Baltimore the young folks going up against blocks with rocks, you remember the Intifada in Palestine where folks went up against tanks and jeeps with rocks. Now if you think about that, that's an insane equation. That's an insane equation to dare think that you can go up against a Glock with a rock, that you can go up against a machine gun with a rock or a tank with a rock, etc., etc. But what that shows you is the depth of desperation and the depth of anger and of being not respected. Because it gets to a point, I remember one time, a long time ago, when I first started my ministry, somebody said to me, they said, people only end up reacting and responding in those kinds of violent ways because they've not been listened to. They've not been respected. They've not been heard. It's the proverbial straw to break the camel's back. So we see these great relationships. That's why when Gaza took off and Ferguson took off, folks were tweeting and sending Facebook photographs to each other, whether in Gaza or in Ferguson or in Baltimore, saying we stand with you, because folks recognize the same picture of tear gas and militarization and police out of bounds. People began to see and understand that there was a clear relationship to what has been going on in the West Bank and the occupied territories, to what has been going on in this country as well. How do we find hope in the midst of these situations? Well, the first thing is you've got to be willing and able to have free and open discourse about it. One thing is that folks have always tried to shut down folks when it comes to talking about Palestine. We cannot have a discussion. Why can't we have a discussion? If you talk about Palestine, you're immediately accused of threatening Israel. If you talk about economic pressure upon the country, you're immediately accused of trying to destroy Israel. I was a part of the Free South Africa movement, where we did use boycott to challenge the apartheid regime of South Africa. It took some time, but it worked. It took some time, but eventually, South Africa had to come around to trying to rejoin the human community all over again. It had to begin to take away its separation laws that separated people and classified people. And so when we talk about economic pressure right now on Israel, it's over the same thing. You know, folks want to say, oh, he's for the destruction of Israel. I'm not for the destruction of anybody. I want to say that loud and clear. I'm not for the destruction of anybody, but I am for justice and fairness and that which is right. And my eyes tell me that the way Palestinians are being treated is not right, because it looks like Jim Crow here in the United States of America, or it looks like apartheid that we struggled against in South Africa. So we need to begin to talk about that, because if Israel wants to save itself, it needs to get on the right side of justice. If Israel wants to save itself, it needs to allow the Palestinians to have rights to their own land, rights to their own dignity, rights to their own self-determination. That is the only way. You know, the fact is, if you understand the Bible, and Alex is visiting with me from down my home, Reverend Vicio, and one thing we always talk about Bible, but one thing you understand is that Solomon, in the scriptures, you heard about Solomon, right? Solomon, they said he was very wealthy. Solomon built the temple in Jerusalem and put gold on it, etc., etc. What the book doesn't tell you is that Solomon got invested in selling arms to all his neighbors. And you know what the result was? He had to have a larger and larger army in order now to protect himself from all his neighbors. And by the end of his life, he had almost bankrupted the country because he had to spend so much money to keep a standing army to protect himself from the folks, his neighbors, that he had armed. That's what happens through militarization, is we basically spend ourselves into oblivion. And the fact is that that is what's going on in the world with Israel, that the United States fund and send all this money and all of these arms to her and end up, in a sense, destabilizing Iraq at war or argument with Iran. I'm glad we're trying to cut a nuclear deal. I'm glad we're doing that. I hope Congress doesn't do the wrong thing. But the fact is I'm glad that what is wrong? I'm a preacher, y'all know. What is wrong with talking to folk? What is wrong with having conversations with folk? What is wrong with trying to find out what your common interest is? What is wrong with trying to make a pathway to coexistence? Now, I want to say this, and it might trouble somebody. I have problems anytime that somebody like in America wants to suggest that we're a Christian country. You know why I got a problem with that? Because if you're a Christian country, that means that somebody who's not Christian doesn't have the same kind of equality and rights and respect that those who are Christian have. I got problems when we talk about an Islamic Republic. Why? Same reason. If you're not Muslim, then you do not have the same kinds of respect that those who are Muslim have. And that's why I have a problem with the Jewish state. The Jewish state, because it ignores the rights of all of those who have different religious perspectives and those who come from different nationalities and different races. And so in a sense, we need to stop with all of this sectarian pronunciation of things, because sisters and brothers, I got news for you. Whether you're Christian, whether you're Jewish, whether you're Muslim, one God made you. One God made you out of one fabric. You may call yourself by different names and different languages, but we find out miraculously that we are truly brothers and sisters to one another. So unless we learn to live together as brothers and sisters, we most certainly perish together as fools. So my message is, let us talk it out. My message is let us work through this. My message is, let us talk about Palestine. Why? Because nobody's talking about Palestine. When we stood up and said, Black Lives Matter, it was a challenge to the world. Because the world did not act as if Black Lives Matter. When we said Black Lives Matter, it was a challenge to the old racist paradigm that Black lives, yes, they are important. Black Lives Matter. And when we said Black Lives Matter, it was also self-affirmation. Because when everything in the society says you don't matter, eventually you end up getting conditioned into thinking that it's normal to be a second or third class citizen. So when we say Black Lives Matter, I'm not only challenging the world, but I'm reminding myself that I'm filled with the humanity that everybody else is filled with. So I got news for you. Yes, we're not denying that all lives matter, but the fact is we're making a statement out of a political reality that currently exists. So I'm here to say to us that Palestinian lives matter. Palestinian lives matter as a defiant act to the world. Palestinian lives matter also as a self-affirmation. Palestinian lives matter because, one, I might be black, but today I'm Palestinian. I understand what it means to live in racism and in a segregated society and to be beat upon for no particular reason whatsoever. And so therefore I have to stand with sisters and brothers wherever they are in the world, stand toe to toe and shoulder to shoulder and say, I am you right now, because you will be me when we stand together and we begin to change the world, because we stand together with one another. Because justice and that injustice over there eventually becomes injustice right here. If I don't stand up, if I don't challenge it, whatever it is, whatever it is, whatever it looks like, then basically I have abdicated. I've abdicated in terms of my own hope and my own embrace of humanity. And I cannot abdicate my embrace of humanity. Why? Because God called me. God called me not to say that you're wrong and you're wrong and you're wrong, but God called me to say, let us come together. Let us be the people that you made us to be. That we might be believers, we might not be believers, we might be Christian, we might be Muslim, we might be Jewish. Let us come together and let us build a world where we're not trying to kill one another and silence each other. Let us build a world where we talk about the truth, where we try to lead folks towards a place where we can all exist together as brothers and sisters on this planet. There is no new geography that's going to be added to this globe we call Earth. What has been made is already made. There's going to be no new ground, no new territory. So we better learn to live in this increasingly small world rather than to try to bomb each other into oblivion or rather try to wipe each other off the map. I want to say one more piece and then we're going to open up for questions, if that's okay. Israel was the establishment, really, of a beachhead in the Middle East for Europe and for the U.S. Most folks don't understand that the so-called Promised Land, the Zionists, first of all, asked for Uganda. And there were already decolonializing struggles going on in the continent of Africa. And basically, the former colonial powers felt that it would really, really, truly disturb things if it happened in the central part of Africa. And as you know, the British were in control. And the Zionists made the argument, which I call the Columbus argument. And the argument was this: we are a people without a land, and Palestine is a land without a people. Even though there were millions of these. It was like Columbus coming to America, though you had a long history of native people who had settled into the lands and were using the land. Somehow they didn't exist. Nobody saw them. Nobody saw them. They just took from them and took from them and took from them and put them eventually on reservations. Well, if you look at the West Bank, it looks like a reservation. There is no difference. All through this experiment called Israel, it is laced with race and racism. That's why the Ethiopians rioted recently around police brutality, because there is that racist paradigm that does exist. And sisters and brothers, in order for Israel to be perfect, we've got to talk about it. In order for Palestinians to become perfect, we've got to talk about it. In order for us as people who live in the United States to become even more perfect, we're not perfect, but even moving towards that way, we gotta talk about our flaws and not be afraid to talk about our flaws, because that's how we reconstruct a world that is not made in our image, but is made in the image of our brothers and sisters who are as equal as we are. Thank you all. Let's open up for some questions.
Times, tales from the dark side, evidence of the settlements on my hard drive. Man, I swear my heart died at the end of that car ride. When I saw that checkpoint, welcome to apartheid. Soldiers wear military green at the checkpoint. Automatic guns, that's machine at the checkpoint. Tables not M16s at the checkpoint. Fingers on the trigger, you'll get leaned at the checkpoint. Little children going adults and teens at the checkpoint. All your papers better be clean at the checkpoint. Gotta put your finger on the screen at the checkpoint and pray that red light turns green at the checkpoint. And Martin Luther King had a dream of the checkpoint. He wake with loud screams from the scenes at the checkpoint. Is Malcolm X by any means at the checkpoint? Imagine if your daily routine was the checkpoint.
And Martin Luther King had a dream of the checkpoint. He wake with loud screams from the scenes at the checkpoint. Is Malcolm X by any means at the checkpoint? Imagine if your daily routine was the checkpoint.
Separation walls that surround in the checkpoint. On top is barbed wire like a crown on the checkpoint. Better have your permits if you found at the checkpoint. Coming on the tower, aiming down at the checkpoint.